It's the late 19th century, and there are over 9,000 windmills in the Netherlands, some of them primarily built to dry the lowlands, called polders. Between the windmills, there are fields filled with colorful tulips, a flower that was once a part of the turbulent history of the first financial bubble, now a quintessential part of the Dutch landscape, especially on the famous Bloemen route, the Blue Man Group, the flower route. Okay, so evidently the flower was once part of the turbulent history of the first financial bubble. So,
have you ever heard of the tulip bubble?
The tulip bubble. I didn't know about that. I do. I work in finance, and this was not on Series 7. I guess they'll have to add some questions about the first financial bubble and the tulip, the Blue Man Route.
Today on the board, boys.
Windmill Valley.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, Season 15, Episode 5. Today on the docket, Windmill Valley from Board and Dice Games. This is your board boy, Cloggin' Rob.
Cloggin' Rob. That's pretty good. It's your boy, Dutch Letter TK.
That is literally what I was going to say.
Dude, Dutch letters are my favorite.
Dutch letters are good. Well, I'm just going to be lame and say your board boy, Tulip Jake.
And this is your board boy, Cam, a.k.a. Boinker McDoinker, a.k.a. Orange Man Cam.
Man, you know what? This is what I like about board games. You're always learning stuff that, like, I don't know, they'll just pick themes of things, and then if you kind of, a lot of times in the rule books, they dig into a little bit of about that thing, right?
Yeah, and good thing for Cam and I is that we never have to learn any of these things.
Hey, I want to say one more thing. It's this is your boy Cam, a.k.a. Boinker McDoinker, a.k.a. Vander Cam. There's a lot of Vanders Dutch, right? Vander
Van,
Cam.
Van Cam.
Van Cam.
Yeah.
Cam, that, wait, where's Vander from? I thought Vander was the...
So is Jean-Claude Van Damme Dutch?
No, he's like Austrian or something, right? Okay. No, that's Arnold. Jean-Claude Van Damme is he French?
Who knows?
His name is Jean-Claude.
I think he's Belgian.
Ooh, I bet that's right.
Let's look up Jean-Claude Van Damme. I'm going to go with Belgian. What do you guys think?
But the Vander, isn't there like a baked beans that's like Vander Camp?
That's Van D Camps.
Oh, Van De Camp. Okay. Well, now we're just way off base. Hold, please.
Belgian martial artist.
What's your favorite Jean-Claude Van Damme movie? Bloodsport?
Bloodsport.
Kickboxer.
Kickboxer's also great.
I only know about Bloodsport and Kickboxer. Wait,
my favorite is Kickpuncher.
What's the one where he like tapes his hand and runs it in glass? That's him, right?
That's Bloodsport.
That's Bloodsport?
Right?
Okay. That one.
I've never seen that movie, but I have seen Hot Shots Part 2 where Charlie Sheen does that with
Is that the movie where they go to some illegal martial arts tournament type thing?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, that's kind of what I thought. It's been a long time since I've seen that, but...
What's that movie where they fight Jean-Claude Van Damme in his house and he does the splits in his kitchen? That's, I remember when they were filming that, and it was in like a Disney Adventures magazine or something like that.
No idea.
Because remember how Jean-Claude Van Damme could do the splits real good?
He can do the splits real good, yeah.
Was he Guile in the Street Fighter movies?
Oh, yeah, that's my favorite Jean-Claude Van Damme movie.
I also really loved, I had to make sure it was him. For whatever reason, as a kid, I really loved the movie called The Quest, which is like a fighting movie in Tibet, and there's like a tournament that they fight in, and Jean-Claude Van Damme's the main character in that.
He was also in Time Cop and a movie called Double Impact. The the cover of Double Impact. The guy's on there. Whoa. I can't handle it.
Yeah, I said Belgium. Yeah, right. I was right. And you know why I thought of this is because he didn't seem French to me, but I always think of Belgium being like the place people always think French, like Belgians are, you always think they're Frenchies, like Poirot is a Belgie, not a Frenchie.
Campbell, there's actually a list of the top 9 Jean-Claude Van Damme splits in movies, so you'll have to be more specific.
Top 9 splits, huh?
Wait, is he Johnny Cage in Street Fighter or is he Guile?
Well, Johnny Cage is Mortal Kombat.
Is he Mortal Kombat too? Is he Johnny Cage?
No. I don't know.
He's not Mortal Kombat.
The one you're thinking of though is the kitchen counter split from Time Cop. So.
Oh, that's in Time Cop.
But the number one was the groin punch split from Bloodsport, which it looks like he does the splits during the match and then punches the dude in the groin.
Man, Jean-Claude Van Damme is in a lot of movies.
Have you seen that guy recently though? I don't think he could do the splits anymore.
I don't think so either, based on this picture I'm seeing of him. where he looks pretty bad.
All right, welcome to another episode of the Jean-Claude Van Damme
like,
Fans
pretty bad
Podcast.
Like, pretty cool.
Oh, man.
That's like bad and also kind of good, right?
Yeah.
I mean, he looks like skeleton Jean-Claude Van Damme. It's fine.
I thought he got big, but maybe I'm thinking of someone else.
No, that's Steven Seagal, yeah. Bro.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Oh, man, Under Siege? How about that for a movie? Remember Under Siege?
Yeah.
Under Siege 2? No?
I haven't seen Under Siege or Under Siege 2.
What?
I did hear a story about Steven Seagal trying to do his own stunt on a movie with a houseboat, and he failed it, and he fell in the water, and the water turned black from his hair dye.
Oh, no. Now I need to watch some really bad 80s action movies.
Yeah.
All right. Well, let's talk about some board games we've been playing. It's been a little hot minute since our last podcast, and played a bunch, going to try to break it up between the next couple of episodes, but I think everything on my list has been played by other people at this table. So the first one I want to talk about is a game from Ravensburger called Mycelia, because everyone's got to have a game about mushrooms now. The designer is Daniel Greiner, and artist is Justin Chan and Matt Paquette and co. Oh, Matt Paquette. That's the guy that gave us the challenge coin at BGGCon.
Oh, no doubt.
Yeah.
That guy's the bomb. And by gave us the challenge coin, what are you trying to say?
I have one, too.
Oh, he gave you one, too?
Yeah.
Oh, now I don't feel as special.
You got yours first, though.
Oh, okay. That's true.
Anyway, shout out to Matt Paquette.
What's the challenge coin?
What's a challenge coin?
I had to learn this when I received one, so Rob can tell you.
Yeah, so like we should make the Board Boys challenge coin. But basically, it's like an old, I think it originally came from more like a military thing. But like if you're in a bar or something and like you have your coin and you put your coin on the table, whoever doesn't have their coin like has to buy drinks, kind of.
Yeah.
Like that's a thing.
You keep it with you because it's you're proud of it because it shows that you're part of the organization.
Yeah. Mm. So like, and you just kind of give people trade them with other people and that kind of thing. So.
Did you just give him like a penny back? Is that?
I didn't actually.
No.
I gave him like stickers. I think because we don't have a coin.
He gave me one because we were having a conversation and I said something that he thought was really cool and I don't remember what. Like he asked me a question about like my thoughts on board games and I said something like high level like how I'm always like dunking on you guys with my thoughts on games.
Yeah.
He disagreed with me and he was like, man, that was brilliant.
That boink McDoinker. He's just the best.
I imagine Campbell sits at home a lot and has one of those like Nerf basketball things on his door, and he just sits there and jams it all day long.
Hey, actually, that wasn't even like my highlight of that night. My highlight of the night was getting like 17 cards in 30 seconds in a run of Time's Up with like the most famous board game people. And I was just sitting there quietly, and I got in on a game with him because we were hanging out with Grant from, and I was laying in the cut, and it was my turn to do. I was like the one word, the easiest one to like nail a bunch, and I just like ran the deck,
crushed it, and
then it was so silent you could have heard a pin drop, and then everybody hoisted me on their shoulders and then threw me down onto the second level of the hotel from the third level restaurant we were in.
I don't think any of that happened. I showed up shortly after and Cam was not in a body cast.
Yeah. The thing about me like crushing a turn of Time's Up is true. But everything else I've said
here is
highly editorial.
Yeah.
There's also, I can't remember the name of this guy. I'll try to share it in the Discord. But there's a dude I'm thoroughly enjoying his reels right now. And they totally remind me of Cam. It's this kind of baldish kind of man on wheelies.
That guy is kind of like me.
Skating around. And like he's doing it to like crazy weird songs. I don't know. It's the most Cam thing I've ever seen.
Yeah, I'm not a Heelys guy ever. I never have been, but that seems like.
I feel like I'll get you a pair of Heelys.
If you give me a pair of Heelys, I'll heel them.
Sweet.
All right, when I get that feeling, I need to go healing.
Mycelia from Ravensburger. This is a super, I would say, entry-level deck-building game. The coolest part of it is you only like play three cards a turn, and that's it. Your cards can give you leaves, which are your money, and then you can buy cards from the row. But essentially, everyone has a board with water drops on it, and your main goal is to empty your board first. So it's a race game, and all the cards do stuff with the drops. Either move them around, some of them just take them off. Some of them depend on what color you're on. Some of them depend on how many are on your board. The cool part is a lot of the cards also give other people stuff, so it kind of ramps up the whole game. And it takes about 30 minutes to play. And then every time, it's got this really overproduced wooden stump that is not really necessary, but kind of fun. And as you drop the water off, you put them in these spots on the stump. And then when you get to a certain spot based on the player count, you roll it, rotate it, and all the water drains out of it. And then the dice also drains out of it and tells you where you have to put either one or two new drops on your board. So every time you kind of put more on there. If you're looking for like a starter level deck building game, check out Mycelia. It was probably the surprise game that I've played since Gen Con that I brought back.
Yeah, it was really good. In fact, I thought it was so good that my buddy texted me the other day and he's like, "Hey, I got all this, credit at GameStop, and I'm thinking about buying the new edition of Talisman because he's not much of a board gamer, but he thought it looked cool." And I was like, "Well, has a way higher rating than the old Talisman, which I thought was kind of clunky, but go for it." And I'm like looking through what board games GameStop sells, and they sell like six games, and Mycelia was one of them. I was like, "Oh, get Mycelia." And he was like, "Oh, we already bought Talisman." So that's my Mycelia story. Yeah, Matt rules. A good guy. Shout out Matt Paquette. Matt, also known as Matt Packett.
I enjoyed the game quite a bit too. It's fun to kind of organize, you know, how you're planning for the future with what cards you get and the different things you can take from there. And there's a lot of really interesting ways that you can remove your water droplets, even outside of just pushing them up through the hole. I do remember thinking that when the water drained out, it was going to be a lot more consequential than it actually was. But I do agree that the stump is really there for novelty. I think it's not quite an age-contrived level of unnecessary compliances that go with a game, but yeah, it's fun. I did enjoy it.
It definitely fills up the box.
Yeah.
That makes the rest of it harder to put away, but it's cool.
Yeah. I wish it was a little bit more meaningful because, like, as far as I'm concerned, it doesn't have, like, that much purpose at all, right? You could just lay the drops on the board and then go, "Okay, everybody take two," or whatever.
You just roll the die, and yeah, then you put some out where it's at based on the card, yeah.
Yeah. But it is neat.
It looks cool. What's next?
I mean, I figured we'd go around.
Yeah, okay, I can do one. Rob mentioned this earlier. I forgot to talk about it even. I have played this twice now. A game I picked up that I've always wanted to play called 18 Holes, because I love everything about golf except for golfing. So I was zazzed to play a golf board game where, I love golf video games. I love miniature golf. I love disc golf. I love anything that is like a golf related thing.
How many times have you actually golfed?
I don't know. In my life?
Yeah.
Let's say less than 50, more than 20.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So like quite a few times. I used to, like, when I was younger, I would go out golfing with like my family and friends and stuff, but I just walk a course with a bag of my old clubs. playing like the municipal courses, and in recent years I've been out much less frequently, maybe like once every other year.
I mean, if you're gonna be a finance guy, you gotta pick it back up.
Yeah, here's the thing, like, no. Please. I'm not a very good I don't like any of the things finance guys like
cocaine.
Yeah, like I don't like cocaine. Quaaludes. I don't like playing golf. I don't like
making money.
Like living in the huge house burbs. And I don't like wearing those vests that zip up that don't have the, you know what I'm talking about, those Patagonia or whatever vests that are puffy.
I'm gonna get you a visor.
Yeah, I could do a visor. I don't like drinking super heavily at conventions. And I don't like bags. I think finance guys like bags, right? The younger ones do.
Like the game cornhole?
Yeah, cornhole. Okay. I like cornhole. I don't like bags, you know? Bags. You don't play bags. So.
No, I don't know.
All right, tell us about this game.
So, 18 Holes is it's a game where you build a golf course out of hexagonal tiles with a bunch of little hexes on them. And the game, the game book comes with a bunch of different courses that were designed by the designer and other and fans. And I think there's a bunch more online, and you could of course design your own courses as well.
I'm just gonna make one real long one that just goes all the way across the room.
Yeah, the hexagons are complex enough where it'd be kind of hard to make a course perfectly without knowing the tiles pretty well. But what you do is, you know, you can play any rules of golf you want. Like the standard rules of the game are you basically whoever just sinks it in the like the smallest amount of shots each hole gets a point, and that like ties are friendly, and then whoever has the most points at the end wins. But you like, we played the second time I played, we played like just strokes, so that nobody was ever truly out of it. Even like, even if you're like six strokes behind, like somebody could totally biff a hole and you can come back. Whereas when you just play a point a hole, you can like, when there's like three holes left, if you're playing 18 holes, somebody could be like long done. But the wrinkle of the game is that you draft five golf club cards at the beginning, and that's your set of clubs for the entire game. And as you play, you have to choose a club to play each turn, and you either have to like take a penalty stroke to get all your cards back, or you have to play all of your cards to get all your cards back. And so on your turn, you play a card, or you get all your cards back by losing a stroke, or you just get them back for free at the, you know, the end once you played all of them. And then with your club, you can either hit the ball like the club would hit the ball, or move your ball one space, or like try to get out of a sand trap, essentially. And no, it's pretty easy to play. It gets a little involved. We played with five people here at Rob's place, and it got a little busy because you have to draw from all these decks to see what your ball does when you hit it. But I think we had like varying levels of enjoyment. I thought it was super, super fun. And I think one of the guys at the table thought it was super not that fun. And I think everybody else was like, yeah, it's fine.
Yeah, I was in the middle. I think five for the first play wasn't a great idea.
We also played a really hard course.
I think the best part of the game is there's like a ton of different variants to play.
Yeah.
So I think that the thing is finding the best variant. I could not imagine playing that game for 18 holes. That would have not been fun.
We played with three players on an easier course the second time I played, and it went way faster.
Did you play all 18?
Yeah. Well, okay. We didn't play an 18-hole course. We played a 9-hole course, but it was the same thing we did.
Yeah. I don't know that I'd ever play 18 holes of that game, but maybe I would.
So here's where I think it slaps. If you have friends who like golf a lot, or you have friends who like this game a lot, I think it's an awesome thing to get out. I think 18 holes could be like where I think these games have a ton of value is it's a perfect game to be a favorite like game of a group of people who play it all the time. Which, you know, I have friends who love like Iron Dragon, which I think is like not necessarily that incredible of a game, but like it's
rips.
Yeah,
it's
mean
so good.
It's fun. It's really fun.
Yeah.
But like that game is an awesome, this family loves this game, like they and their friends like play it all the time. 18 holes is the bomb for that, especially because you can like really mess with the difficulty. Like everybody picks a character card, and some of the, like they all give you an ability, but if you flip them to the other side, they actually give you a detriment. So like people who are really good can take a detriment, and people who have not played before can take a special ability. Yep, tons of different rules. I think it's an awesome solo game.
Yeah, I could see that.
Because like I think there's like a community, and you can like go post your scores you've gotten on different courses. You can upload courses, I think, to the website that you've created. I think it's a great community game. There's also a couple expansions that I haven't played, but one adds putting into the game, which I think could be really, really fun. And then another one I think just adds like a bunch of fun, freaky course building type things. So
yeah, I think the other thing we could have done, and it's maybe harder with five, but I think the game you can really kind of play simultaneously.
Yeah.
And with five, we were kind of going around the table. And like, we tried one turn to go simultaneous, and it kind of got goofy because there's a thing where you'd be like, well, I want to do like swing extra hard. So then people got to like draw extra cards.
Draw from different, because there's like six different decks. The one other con I'd say I have on the game, since I love it, but we probably won't do a full episode on it, is that there's a weird card in every deck that like makes you shuffle the deck. And the way the rules are written, it's kind of arbitrary after the first shuffle. The shuffle card just goes down at the very bottom. So I like just pulled them out. But I think it's probably intended to be in there so you shuffle it every time you hit it. And so you never really know like what's still in the deck. It's kind of like playing blackjack, right?
Yeah, I also think we played, maybe I don't know exactly what all the different game modes do, but I think we played maybe the worst one because the reason why I think my buddy Ben didn't like it was he knew for a fact he couldn't win after the first like five holes.
Exactly. And so,
because you only get 1 point per hole and he had not scored a point yet.
Yeah, so he's just done.
Yeah, so...
Which is why you do stroke play.
Yeah. I think we just didn't play it the best way, probably for the first time, for sure.
Exactly. And you know, you can just keep the game going, too, if you play in, like, the race mode, where, like, you just start the next hole the turn after you finish a hole, and then just whoever finishes the course first wins.
Yeah, I like to think of it as, like, speed golf. Remember when people used to do that and, like, take, like, three clubs on a course, and you, like, run and play golf?
Yeah, exactly. It's like that. So here is one other big pro. It looks awesome on the table because there's a bunch of little miniature trees you place on the tree spots. And you have these little golfers that sit in the spots, and you have like a flag for every hole too. So that makes it look really good.
All right, I got just one I'm going to talk about. So I got on Kickstarter recently and played several times now already at Creature Caravan. So it is both designed and the artist is Ryan Lacat, and it's Red Raven Games. So it's their newest. I guess I don't really know how to describe the mechanism. It's kind of multi-use cards, but you have a caravan. And the board lays out in front of you. It has four different tiles. I don't know the dimensions right now, but they're grids. And then there's different landscape that are in different spots. And then you can actually flip the boards over and put them in a varied order, so the path is you know pretty consistently different. And then there's a city at the end that you're trying to move towards. But basically, what you're doing is you have your hand of cards that you're given at the beginning of the game, and then kind of similar to Taverns of Tiefenthal, you roll dice, and then you place the dice on the cards. Unlike that, the pip value on a card means any pip that's a higher pip number than that can go there. But there are actions that let you move. There are actions that let you do this trade market where you are trading coins or these purses in for victory points. And there's kind of a cool race mechanism within that where if somebody trades – at the 2 gold rate, you put a little cube on it, and then after one more turn, nobody else is able to trade at that rate. So you get one turn after they've done it to do the same spot. And the same goes for fighting the ember zombies that you run across. So as you move through spaces where they exist, you pick them up. And if you don't fight them and defeat them at that moment, they're worth negative points at the end of the game. But similar to that market, there is a fighting market, and it basically determines how strong the zombie is. And so the number of pips that you assign to the fighting spaces that you have out, that is a market as well. So if you defeat a zombie with 5 pips, there's one more round for somebody to defeat them at that level, but then they have to go to higher levels, which effectively can box people out of that part of the game. So it's really neat. You score points based on how many horizontal columns that you move through. There's a bonus for reaching the end of the city. You also, every time you stop your turn, you lay a tent, and there are 12 of them, and that's kind of the game clock. So once you've done 12 rounds, you've placed 12 tents out, then the game is over. So every space where you have a tent is also worth a point, so moving consistently is good for adding points that way. There's a lot of really cool synergy that you can build. It definitely has a gigantic deck of cards, which I know is similar to what we played with Evenfall on the last review. If that's not something that you particularly like, you certainly will be looking at a fair amount of cards. But also similar to Evenfall, you can discard them to get resources, although the rate's not very painful. But it's really interesting. I've really enjoyed my play so far. I've played it 4 players and 2 players 2 different times, and it's everybody plays simultaneously, so it goes pretty quick, especially if you're with a pretty fast group. So I am very, very much enjoying it and want to keep playing it.
One comment, Ryan Lacat. Not only would I say he's like obviously the most prolific guy who designs and does all the art for his own games. I don't even know if I can name another designer who does that.
No, him and his wife are like a 1-2 punch with all that stuff.
Yeah,
their own company, own designs, own art, own graphic design.
Yeah, like unbelievably successful for what they do.
100%.
And I wouldn't say that I've ever like loved one of those games. I might love like the bigger adventure one if I played it some.
Sleeping Gods.
Yeah, I'd like to play that one.
But,
I've never played
it.
But I
always still like I see Near and Far on my shelf and I'm like, I want to play the campaign. We played the first few games of the campaign, but it's long. Isn't it like 15 games long or something?
I don't
like
know.
That?
I don't own it anymore.
Oh, man. Well, I still do. Maybe we should play the campaign even though we have 100 other games to play.
100%.
I'll play it with my wife because she likes to play the same thing a bunch of times. Deanna is... I have found my wife's wheelhouse for board gaming. She likes legacy games. We're playing...
she didn't like My City. But now you're playing
she
My Island.
She didn't like My City, but that was when she was like new. Like, I got her into Legacy games with Ticket to Ride Legacy, and now she really enjoys it. I think she enjoys playing the same game a bunch of times.
Yeah.
And so having like some exciting thing to do. I'm going to go ahead and say it. A few plays into My Island. Maybe it changes, but I like it way more than My City. And it doesn't have the same like high ratings, but I think it the envelopes are more exciting because there's like they're like thick, and when you open them, like stuff falls out, you know. And the gameplay I think is more fun.
I've really enjoyed My Island. I've kind of hit a stagnant place of recent, but I definitely really enjoy it.
We have three games left, and it's currently sitting open on my shelf in there because we're about to finish it. So.
Usually,
we'll see how it ends up.
Usually when Deanna and I sit down to play a game, like we are able to mark some time away. So we've been able to do three games at a time every time. So we're running through it like pretty good, even though we only play like once a week. Tim?
I haven't played anything. I had work and COVID. So
yeah.
I haven't done anything.
So
we did a play at T-Wall.
Who's busier at work this year, you or me?
Busy or productive?
Either.
Tim is on the phone all day, every day.
That's me too.
I would say that I am probably busier. You are probably more productive.
It has been. We've made a lot of hay this year.
Yeah.
But I've been like, remember how when I started this job, I'd be like, hey, I can just come hang anytime because like I can get my stuff done in the middle of the night or I can do it like, you know, and now it's like, yeah, I'm working tonight and tomorrow in the morning and in the afternoon as well.
I know. I used to hear from you during the day. I don't hear from you anymore.
Oh, dude. I used to remember how I used to be like just have a window of BGA open like all day, like doing my work, and I'd like rip through my games. And now I'm like, I have to like go get the stack done every single night and like go play each one of my turns so I'm not late. That's like my nightly ritual. And then I like look at the clock and I'm like, well, time to take my heart medicine and go to bed.
I feel like Tim asking to be on our Ultimate Frisbee email list was probably an overreach. I have yet to see Tim at a lunch break.
I'll get there sometime. I mean, you know.
Winter is coming.
I'll get there sometime in 2025.
Do you think there's an end of your busyness in sight? Because I think I'm going to be much busier next year than I was this year. And then I think it's going to get way easier after that.
No. I think it's just going to get busier.
You're crazy? All right. Well, if you ever need somebody, just send me like two and a half hours of your work every single day.
Yeah,
I'll subcontract
it. Yeah,
you just need an assistant.
Yeah, I got two.
You need a good assistant.
Yeah. I think they're both. I mean, I wouldn't call them assistants. I would call them help.
Direct reports.
Yeah. I mean, I have 30 direct reports.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, then they're your assistants.
Yeah. They're something. Yeah. Yeah.
All right. Well, I have a couple more to talk about. One is Stonespine Architects. This is the new one from Thunderworks Games, and it's in their role player universe, which I've been kind of digging lately. I actually backed their new gambling game. I forget what it is, like Greedy Goblins or something. And then
I like that.
As part of the Kickstarter, they had a thing that I just did the pledge manager. And they're like, hey, do you want lockup and the expansion and some cool tiles and some promos for like $50? And I was like, and it's like a over $100 MSRP. I'm like, I used to own that. Well, I think Josh had a copy that I had for a while. And I remember really liking it. So I was like, sure. So I have that now, too. I'd never played the expansion. So I'm going to have Stonespine Architects. And I'll have a little shelf of just role player games, except for no role player.
That's fine.
I played that one like once. I think Cam had that. I think we were not.
I think I still do.
Yeah.
I didn't like it for what it was at that time.
We should play it again.
I will say, role player is one of probably the last games that I was pretty sour on that I was pretty excited for that just, I think, it just wasn't what I wanted it to be quite exactly.
Yeah.
And I wonder now if I went back to play it, if I'd be like, oh, no, this is actually really good because of all these things. Now that I've played 1,000,000,000 board games.
I think they have a cool bigger game, too, where you can take your role player character that you roll in that game.
And then go do an adventure with it?
Yeah.
And that sounds really cool, yeah.
Yeah, it sounds neat. Have any of you played Lockup?
Isn't that like, they have like a role player legacy? Okay. Isn't that what it is?
That I don't know.
Okay.
That might be part of it, but you have played Lockup. That's like their worker placement game.
Yeah, where you're trying to like get out of the clink. Yeah, I played it with Josh because we got a free copy of it like way back in the day.
Yeah, yeah.
Role Player Adventures.
Yeah, is that a legacy game?
I thought so.
I know that's the one where you can bring your role player character into it. I don't know. Maybe I'm going to get all into the role player stuff.
The Rollerverse.
Yeah. So anyway, Stonespine Architects. Oh, and like also Cartographers is in there.
Yeah, Cartographers is a huge success. Dude, what about a role player game where you play your character on the map you created? Except for that those maps are like really terrible maps because you're just trying to get points out of them.
Yeah.
So this one's designed by Jordi Adan, and the art is also by Jordi Adan and some other people.
Look at that.
But, and this one, it is a quick 4-round card drafting game. And every round you draft 4 cards and you pass left, right, and you're filling up 1 row of your dungeon, and you fill up a row every round, and you have a card that has an entrance and an exit on it and some requirements. And if you meet all the requirements, you score some points. You also get money for the stuff, your cards that you take. And then there's like a bidding round where you buy more stuff to put in your dungeon. Anyway, this is a game where you score points about 7 or 8 different ways. You also get a draft, like these objective type cards. And there's like a group objective that you're all trying to fight over. I don't know. It's a super quick 30-minute little tableau builder point soup salad kind of thing, and I really like it. It's pretty easy to play, and it's got the cool whoever has the most money gets to go first thing, and then if you spend money and you still have the most money, you get to go again. So it's kind of like patchwork with the turn order.
That's cool.
On that, so yeah, Stonespine Architects. I highly recommend it. And there's a watch it played video. I can see that right here on the page. Last one I want to talk about is Reef Project, and I'm talking about this because I played it a bunch, and we're probably not going to do an episode on it, but it is also by Board and Dice and also coming out around this time. The designers Martino Cicciera and Federico Pierlorenzi, and it is by Board and Dice. In this one, you are trying to clean up the reefs. Right? That's totally the theme. Because
they're dirty. There's trash everywhere.
It's very theme forward.
By constantly throwing plastic bottles into the ocean routes that you traverse across?
Yeah, no, those are like real things. Yeah. They're like soaking up the pollution.
Gotcha.
I guess. The reef balls.
How about the mechanisms where you just throw them away, though? Because that happens too, right?
You can do that. and you can be like, I'm not going to help the ocean as much, but I'm going to score some points from it.
Well, maybe what you're doing is you're actually donating reef balls to places that need them, and they're taking them and putting them in their oceans.
So anyway, in this game, you're basically putting these reef balls out on the board, and it costs you energy to do so. Then you move your boat to an island, and then you can either do the action on the island, or you can play a card. Depending on what kind of card you play, you might also be able to do the action on the island. And the game's just a bunch of different action symbols, and they do a bunch of different things. There's a bunch of different ways to score points. There's like an area control element out on the board. There is kind of a race to kind of collect these garbage tokens on the board as you're cleaning things up. It has something in the game that I've never really seen before where you're racing to a certain number of points, and that's when it ends. I mean, I've seen that, but halfway through that race, there's a spot where you actually draft endgame objectives in reverse score order, and I don't think I've seen that in a game before.
And it's meaningful.
It is. You can score, I mean, like 15 points out of it. I don't know. The first time we played this game, I will say the rule book is god-awful. It's terrible. It's really bad. So we played it incorrectly, and nobody liked it. And I learned how to play it correctly, and I played it 3 or 4 times since then, and I really, really like Reef Project. And it plays pretty quick. I mean, Windmill Valley also plays pretty quickly, but this one is, I would say, a little lighter than Windmill Valley, and it plays, you know, in 60 to 90 minutes, even with 4 players. So
I don't know. I think they're, like, exactly the same weight, if you asked me. Also, I like Reef Project more than I like Windmill Valley. That's a spoiler of the episode. I think it's a phenomenal game.
Ooh, spoilers.
I don't think I really liked it that much. I did really, really well because I just kind of rushed scoring points and got a whole bunch of points for stuff. But I want to play it again, but I don't know. It just felt kind of disjointed in most of the things that you were doing to me. But I don't know. I'd like to try it again.
It just has like lots of mini games on the board, kind of, right? And you can do those to combo to do actions. Like
I love mini games with combos.
Yeah, you can go down there and like scuba dive down there on the track and clean the reef. Or you can drop stuff and score points. I don't know.
Here's another spoiler. I think I like Windmill Valley more than I like Barcelona. So there we go.
That's just all the Board and Dice games right there.
What about Arborea?
I don't know if I've played Arborea.
That's not a board and dice game either.
Oh, but it's
not.
Danny Garcia. We named the other two Danny Garcia games.
That's true.
Arboretum. Have I played that?
It's the one that Tim loves.
I've played Arboretum.
It's not Arboretum. It's
It's kind of Zulkin-y with the tracks that people are on and then the bumping.
Let me look at Arboretum. Arboretum.
Tim wants to play it again.
I would play it again.
Oh, dude, I haven't
because
played
I like
this game.
Hanging out with you guys.
Before this... I get rid of it, I'm gonna play it again.
Yeah.
Oh, you're thinking about getting rid of it?
I mean, I don't know.
Yeah.
But before I would,
this game looks like a game I would like.
It's fun, Cam.
This must have come out when my baby was really young, huh?
It scores real wacky.
The scoring's not overly pleasant.
That's a ringing endorsement.
Neither is playing
right there.
It. So what? Perfect. I said neither is playing it. So
I think I don't know. Actually, I don't know how I feel about it.
I would say with the groups I've played it with, you're in the majority of people that have not enjoyed. Like, I don't think that's a game you're going to really enjoy on play one.
That's probably true. I think honestly though, I liked it a little bit less on the second play.
Okay.
Yeah.
That's fair. Mm. All right. Well, tonight on the podcast we played Windmill Valley. It is by Danny Garcia and the publisher's Board and Dice. Artist is Pedro Codeco and Zbigniew M. Gelter. I love that guy.
Thank you, Zbigniew.
Yeah.
M. Gelter.
It is currently ranked 2,303 with a 7.9 rating.
I'm glad you remember to say that. You forgot to say it till the end of the podcast last episode, and you made me go back and insert it.
Thanks, Cam.
And I did it. If you guys didn't notice the cut, I did it pretty flawlessly.
Well done.
Flawless execution.
In this game, you're competing to build windmills and plant tulips. That's what it says. It's 1 to 4 players, best at 3, ages 14 plus. Playing time is 45 to 90 minutes. The weight is 2.92 out of 5. Tim, why don't you tell us what you do in Windmill Valley?
Ooh. All right. Can I see this? All right, in Windmill Valley, you are raising and lowering the water level to feed your tulip fields and spin these wheels that let you do one of, I believe there's 6 different actions. So as you spin this thing around, you can spin it multiple times, and that lets you kind of select the actions. So actions you can do, you can put windmills out, which let you do more actions, which is fantastic. You can collect character cards and upgrades, which then upgrade your windmills and upgrade. The character cards have both player powers, individual player powers, and scoring criteria on the top or bottom. So depending on where you slot it on your board, you can plant tulips in your field on your little personal board. Those will then combo into certain actions that you can do and gain you money and points, those sorts of things. And then the last two things you can do is you can go to the market, which is in the central board, which lets you get tulips and plant tulips. And you can go to trade your tulips, which basically ship them off, country, send them somewhere. And sending them somewhere lets you then do kind of two actions that are next to them. Those actions are the same actions that were just described. Or you can take all the tulips off the ship and then cycle into a new ship. You play this over basically spinning your wheel through the 6 little actions you can do on your wheel. You can spin them multiple times, so it just kind of depends on how people are moving their wheel and how fast they're moving them. And you play through, 4 different rotations of your wheel to kind of a main line. And as you move that through, you get different bonuses for ending the round. Once one person does their 4th spin, everybody gets a final turn. You finish the round, everybody gets a final turn, and you score the points. That's about it. Let's get to the table, and we'll be back.
I listen to the wind of my soul. Where I'll end up, well, I think only God really knows. I've sat upon the setting sun, but never, 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 never. I never wanted water once, no, never, never, never. I listen to my words, but they fall far below. I let my music take me where my heart wants to go. I swam upon the devil's lake, but never, 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 I'll never make the same mistake. No, never, never, never.
All right, we're back with our initial thoughts on Windmill Valley. Campbell, hit us up.
So I really like the way this game looks, so I was excited to play it. I like the idea of having a flower garden. I like any game about gardening and making flowers or crops or things like that. It's not probably, like, Jake, I think his love stems from Agricola, probably. Probably his love of gardening and flowering and games like that. My thing is I'm such a Harvest Moon, but now these days Stardew Valley stan. And, like, any game where you, like, farm and do crops and things like that really appeals to me. I don't know. I like that thing. I like, maybe it's just because I'm from Iowa, unlike you guys. So I was pumped. I think this game, once I saw the stuff on it and, like, thinking about who the designer was, it kind of shook out exactly sort of like I thought it would. I'm still thinking about what I did wrong in today's gameplay, where I tried to push the wheel super fast but didn't end up with as many points as the rest of you guys, which would suggest to me that I like this game pretty well. So we'll see if I still feel that way when we get to the end of the review.
So I didn't know a ton about this ahead of time. Tim mentioned it to me for a couple months about it coming, and he was pretty hyped about it. So I guess that got me interested. I certainly agree with Cam that it looks beautiful when you have it on the board. It's so vibrant and certainly draws you in. And the, you know, the action selection wheels that rotate are certainly a unique little mechanism. So I was definitely pretty pleasantly surprised upon my first play.
Yeah, I was super excited about getting this one, and it looks great. The wheels looked very fun. And then I really do love Barcelona quite a bit. And I kind of just buried that he had another game. What? Just forget about that one. Arborio or whatever. Just doesn't even exist. So but with Danny Garcia games, I think it's, I thought it was going to be really good, and I was pleasantly happy with the first play.
Yeah, this one I saw.
Oh, this is your first time playing?
No.
Oh, okay.
On my first play.
No, like, Board and Dice normally is like an insta, let's check it out.
They've been ruling lately.
Yeah, man. And when I saw this one, I was like, tulips? I don't know that I care. And I noticed it was Danny Garcia. And, like, I like Barcelona, not as much as Tim. I don't know if anybody does like as much as Tim.
Not at this table.
I mean, I like Barcelona a lot, but...
when you can pull off, 90-point turns for Cam,
yeah.
Like, then...
So I didn't really look
that
at it too
cool.
much. I knew it was going to be a bit lighter, but then as soon as I saw the action wheels, I was like, oh, yeah, I'm in. I love those things. So that's what hooked me, basically, was the cool little action wheels.
I saw the little garden and I was like, oh, I like that.
So,
was my thing.
I mean, that's my first pro. I really like the action selection in this game. I like the fact that you have to pick between the left and right wheel, and the fact that you can upgrade your action wheel is probably one of the more interesting parts to me. I really like the ones, I think the most, for me, the most important tiles to get are the ones that have the little plus sign on them that let you do both actions. And it's cool that both wheels are different sizes, so those actions on the left and right wheel are always going to slap together differently every time around. Also, all four action wheels are in a different order,
yep.
So no one is playing the same game to start out with.
Not to mention, when you upgrade your action wheel in the game, you can actually upgrade either side, so you can sort of create really cool combos of what you're going to be doing in the game. I just said a couple minutes ago that I was thinking about what did I do wrong this game, and I realized that during the course of the game, I upgraded my action wheel with a lot of those like plus wheels, and I feel like I should have put some of them on the left side, because I think what I did wrong in the game, you guys, I figured this out, is I never actually spent like the water flow. And if I'd gotten that as an additional action with some of the other thing, I could have racked up some points too. Because I wasn't catching points during the whole game. I was just pushing the thing as hard as I could, but only taking a single action.
I mean, I probably scored 15 to 16 total points out of that.
Yeah.
Because I got 8 like in the final round.
Yeah. Anyway, how you build your board out is really cool in this game. You get to build out your action wheel and your upgrades and your like some end game scoring by taking like 2 separate upgrading actions. And I love upgrading, so that's super fun to me. And I kind of with my strat today, I had to forego one of those 2 things a little bit, and it felt really sad, and I got 4th place.
I think kind of adding on to that in regards to the upgrades and what you can do to your wheels, you know, there are, you know, as Tim mentioned, what we said, 6 main actions.
Yep.
In those, you know, there's a lot of games where you just may not take certain actions if you're leaning a certain way. But not only can you just avoid certain actions, but you can just build over those actions. So you can double down on the things, on the actions that you're taking more frequently and better versions of those to allow them to come up more regularly. And I think that's a lot of fun. And it's not, you know, there are games where if you eliminate certain mechanisms, you just can't function. Like, you get bogged down and get stuck, and that's not a way that this really operates. I mean, I guess you can kind of run yourself out of money if you don't give yourself a way to get back that. But for the most part, you really are allowed to customize your game to how you want to play it.
Yeah, and upgrading the action wheel makes it each game feel different, even though you're really taking the same actions. Like, it lets you really, you know, customize your experience. And I'm going to add to that, my other pro would be the character cards. So you slot them in the top, and so the character cards have like 2 things on them, the top and the bottom. So the top is a upgrade, so like something that happens. So if you do an action, you get a point, or you get an extra dig, or when you dig, you get to lower the water level. So you can slot them in there, or on the bottom where you do an end game contract, where basically scores X amount of points for things. I like that the 2 things that are on them are tied together. So, like, generally, if it's, like, scoring something for tools, it will be something that gets you tools on top, right? So, like, you can't double dip there for the most part. And then, like, the thought between, oh, I really do need this on top, or I want it on the bottom, or anything like that, I think it just makes your board different. Every time that you play, you go after different things. It makes it feel nice to take that action. It's not just like, oh, I'm gonna get a player power, or I'm gonna score end game cards. You can do either one, you can replace them, you can kind of do whatever you want, and it makes it feel different every time.
Yeah, and finding synergies in there is really fun. Today's the first day I think I really did that well, and it was a big reason why I think I won, as far as I had a pretty cool combo, and like, I've never felt so wobbly in this game as I did today, just because there's so much of this leads to that, that leads to this, that does this, and you get this, and there's just a lot of that going on. So my turns felt longer than they normally were because I had so many things to do. And I like the fact that you can cover up actions to make your wheel stronger by doing certain actions like multiple times. And then you just find the ways to do the other actions you want to do maybe less times a different way. And sometimes it's through the cards. Sometimes it's through building a windmill. I think the only action that I think you can't really ignore is probably building windmills. I don't know. It's one of those where you kind of got to do everything, but I feel like you just do 1 or 2 things a lot less than everything else.
Yeah. It's kind of hard to ignore, like, upgrading at least a little bit and also getting your windmills out. I think what today's play taught me is... Yeah, I don't think it's the same thing like Barcelona, where it's like the main way you get points in Barcelona is just by scoring that bottom track by building something. But I realized today that in this game, like, you get a lot from every windmill you build. And so a way I got a lot of my windmills off my board to score was just by sacking them, which would have been a fine auxiliary action for me, but that's the way I got most of my windmills off. Putting windmills on the board in this game gives you a lot of stuff.
Yeah, well, give you 2 or 3 like total actions.
Yep. Yeah. So,
which may then trigger like one of your cards that you have.
And that's why it's called Windmill Valley. And so there is a thing. Here's the thing, though. I don't think it feels bad. Like, some games where there's like one like way you can do something that starts to feel oppressive, like you just have to do it. It doesn't feel as oppressive in this one because that action, like, even though I only did it like twice this game at the actual action, like it felt so good when I did it that I think it removes all those negative feelings. Like, I gotta do windmills. I think you're like, you feel lucky to be able to do a windmill. And that's,
if you pivot into windmills in the last half of the game, you actually end up in the spots that are really good. And the, because like a lot of the first spots for put, because you put the windmills from like basically the market out, yeah, and the first spots are not great.
Cheap, they're, but not great.
Yeah, they're cheap, but you get like you get a dollar and a tulip, and the last spots are, you get an upgrade, you get a character card, you get to lower the water twice, and you get two tulips.
Yeah, but early in the game, getting a dollar and a tulip feels pretty good too.
Sure, I mean, sure, but like, you know, if you're sitting around waiting on it, like you can still get them out at the end, yeah, and do everything you want to do at the beginning.
And you're just giving people a couple of points, right, for their windmills.
Yep.
Yup.
One thing that I think is becoming a pro for me is the water level thing. The first couple plays, I thought it was fairly inconsequential or not that interesting as far as raising and lowering the levels. And I know I listened to The Secret Cabal, and when they reviewed it, they kind of said the same thing. I think it is the opposite of that, and it's very maybe group dependent.
It was very dynamic tonight.
It was, yeah, fun made tonight. It very, and like, time it's been,
yeah,
fun for me.
Yeah, it was way more interesting, and I think this is a game much like Great Western Trail, where you can choose to go, or Pirates of Maracaibo. You know, you can pick how fast you go with the wheel and how fast you're spinning, and that's how the game ends, is somebody's wheel goes around like four times, and every time your wheel goes around, your marker moves one to the right, and you get some bonuses. Well, first of all, fighting over those bonuses is a pretty big deal because you get some cool stuff. But then using the cogs to like spin faster or spin lower, but then also getting points potentially and dumping extra money into that to get more stuff, or pushing the water level up so then you can lower the water level back down and get points and money. Or, you know, sometimes it hits the top of that track and then people can't spin the thing as far and they have to go down and do only a one spin.
They take worse actions.
Yeah, I feel like tonight, and maybe I just need to like spend a couple games of this counting my turns. Even though I was the slowest tonight, I still won. But I feel like I went faster than maybe I think this game was fairly fast. I think Campbell really spun the wheel quite a bit.
I went one space three times in the game.
Yeah, maybe our first game we went this fast because my friend Ben really spun it the first time too. But the trick is, don't be afraid of skipping actions and find out how you get those actions other places. Mm. And that's usually from getting better cards and getting cool windmill spots.
All right, I got one kind of, we talked about it, but one, the teach for this game is very easy. And you can do it like rolling. So like,
the rule book's really good.
Yeah, my wife and I just, hey, here's how you spin the wheel. You're going to spin it once. Just take this action. And by the time we were four turns into the game, we had done all the actions, right? Because we have two different wheels. And she was like, okay, cool, I got it. And we were 10 minutes into the game and she understood how to play all six actions. They all basically do the same things. Like, there's no like real, you start getting to the end of the game, they do different. Like, the actions, they're the same all the time. And it went real smooth. It was really easy. And then we started messing with the water and all that other stuff. And it really ramped her into the game. And it makes it feel less heavy than I think it actually is. It's not very heavy, but like getting into it is very quick and easy, and the teach is pretty simple. And I don't know, it seems a lot smoother than most games.
Yeah, it only gets heavy, I think, when you start really comboing stuff together mid to late game, when you got a lot of stuff going on and you can trigger those cards. And then maybe trigger, like, especially when you build a windmill and you do three things, and then each of those three things maybe trigger something on your board. Keeping track of all that stuff can be difficult.
Yeah, I was definitely going to go into that when we got to cons, that it can, because things can combo into other things, and then you need to complete turns before you do other things, but then the order of that can matter because there are penalties if you hold too many tulips and things of that nature. It just can get kind of wishy-washy with how a turn's going, and it's just not really possible to audit anybody when that happens, and so you just got to kind of take their word for it. But when you're activating so many things, it can be easy yourself to lose track of where you are amongst those things. Now, I really like combos, and so that's something that I enjoy a lot, but I definitely can see that being to the detriment of some people who don't necessarily track that as well.
And if you have to audit everybody else's turns,
don't play this game.
Yeah, I mean, or play it at two players.
Yeah.
You know, like, but we also don't audit people's turns. There's a ton of games that it would just be impossible to play. So,
yeah. Especially because you're playing with me at the table. I'm like, oh, I get like a purple and a white flower, but I can take actually whatever flowers I want. Here, let's finish this turn. I'm like, oh, actually, I'm taking this turn next time. So I'm going to put back my purple flower and get a red flower. No, actually, I'm going to put that red flower back and get a yellow flower. Let's just get two yellow flowers. So I'll put that white one back. And that's like, that's me, where it's like all legal, but it's like, I can just imagine like a couple guys I know from like the board game meetup at Tuesday that would look at me like.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, Cam, you generally kind of do this where you take your turns a little bit out loud, you know, so like you could also just be sitting there thinking all that stuff in your head for 5-10 minutes and not saying anything. And, you know, you would have gone through all those steps. You just wouldn't have actually done it. Right. Does that make sense? So I actually like that you narrate it because it kind of helps you follow along to what you're doing. So,
yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Other pros?
That is true.
Cons, prawns.
Well, no, I think there's I don't know if anybody said this, but not only is the windmill building fun and the water wheel fun, but every action of this game is pretty fun because you always have a choice in what you're picking up when you're upgrading, even where you can like wipe stuff out kind of Praga style and see a few more. When you go around like that market, you kind of have some choices when you play in the, like, I'm still never taken this action to this day, but when you play a tulip down in like in the shipping area, you get to choose like where you're putting it and pick like two pretty strong rewards.
Am I the only one that did that action today?
Yeah. I've not done it in any of the times I've played this game.
I did it twice in this game. I think I've done it almost every game.
Hey, Prawn, maybe the shipping action is really good and we're just not taking it.
It could be.
So that was one of the things I was going to go into for cons. And I don't know that it's really fair to say that it's not a good action when I literally haven't seen anybody really play it. But it probably says something about that mechanism that I haven't seen anybody really play it. But on the same note, I don't feel like I saw very many endgame scoring cards that were related to doing a lot of the boat action.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, I don't know how you could.
Yeah.
So, but I mean, that just every other action does.
I feel like the boat action is there.
The boat action
to give you like the exact thing. Maybe you need it the exact time. Like just one more way to get it.
Mini expansion idea. You just slap down a track, and then everybody gets a wooden boat. And every time you take the action, you just go up on the track.
Yeah.
And you could have some endgame scoring cards around it, or you could just have like endgame points for being, or like at the end of like when you cross your water thing, maybe you get like an extra bonus based on how far you are.
Yeah, there should be like
track.
A shipping track associated.
Exactly.
With it. Nailed it.
It is a little bit like there's a little bit of punishment to it in that you have to pay a tulip, which ends up being a little bit costly to do, you know, paying a tulip to take a character.
And they have to be different colors too.
And they have to be different colors, so that's a little rough. And so I can.
Unless you have
totally
tech
agree.
Or whatever.
Yeah, unless you have tech. Like, it's just, it feels not as good.
But if it's full, you get to take them all, which is cool. But it's never full in our game.
Yeah. If there's,
you can take the tulips off of the card.
Yeah.
And then you throw the card away.
Yeah.
So
I did.
When you finish the card, you get all.
No. You can either put one on or take them all off.
Yeah.
And then you get to do the action.
Then the card's gone. Nope.
Oh, okay. I see.
I don't know. Yeah, that just doesn't. It just doesn't feel. I mean, it deserves more plays and to see how, you know, how useful it is. And again, Rob used it and he won in this case, but I don't know, it just doesn't feel like the rest of the game. And so I think that there's something kind of weird there. Also, going back to the water level stuff, I do think that this game changed my opinion on it a little bit as well, but I think because that's so dependent on the way the game is played, that track can also just be really uninteresting. So if you are playing with a lot of people that are just going to slow play it, then it's just going to sit at the bottom, and then that action is basically worthless to lower the water. So, I mean, it depends on your style of gaming, but I would imagine that a lot of people that play this game, and a lot of people that play games anyways, like to build machines and then, you know, build those engines and then reap the benefits of them. And so it takes a certain type of gamer to understand the inherent value of pushing it and making it end faster than the other people may be ready for.
But
and
I like
so,
to build my machine and use all the spaces.
Yeah, but
because it's a
know.
Giant machine.
I just think that part of this game could lend itself to being interesting or not at all interesting, depending on the group you're playing with.
I agree. I mean, I could see just moving it one every single time and never messing with it. And like, I think the game could still be fun for that group of people.
Sure. It's kind of weird how much that aspect of the game depends on the people that are playing it.
Very much so.
So, there's also some kind of weird getting used to the order of which how everything happens with the water level. So raising it, and then when do you add the steps? And okay, did we add those steps? And then, nope, you can't actually move it up that far. So it's not that it's too complicated. It just, I don't know. It probably takes some intentional effort to understand it. And if it's not an interesting part of the games you're playing, you're just never going to devote that energy to learning the eccentricities of how that works.
You have to pay attention to doing it. It's definitely a doing all the steps on it is easy to forget.
Yeah, I like how you can wipe pretty much everything in the game, like Campbell said, and see new. But there's not a lot of them in there. But a con for me is I think you can have just wildly different end game scoring cards. And some of them can just score way more than others. And you might just luck sack into the one that like works for you. And then you may be building towards a certain one and then they never get the chance to buy that card.
Yeah.
So that's kind of a weird thing. Like to counteract that, you could just take them early and then work towards them, I guess. But this is the first time I've ever won tonight, and it was because I kind of went hard at everything, but especially I got all three bottom row cards, which I've never done before. And even though you guys still outscored me in all of those because you guys scored a billion points off of them.
I will say I scored 50 points from one goal card.
Yeah, and I scored 30 between all three of mine, or like 32 or something, or 34.
Yeah, I kind of forgot when we were playing that so many endgame cards now in board games, like designers have learned, like, hey, let's limit the amount of points you can get on these things. And so the first couple I grabbed were like, oh, I'll fill this row, so I'll get 10 points there, because if I fill this row, I get 10 points.
Yeah.
And then I see one come up that's like five times every time you do this, and I'm like, that's much better.
Mm-hmm.
Like, that's so much better. I had to do so much work to get these 10 points.
Yeah, those are harder. I mean, I think they're harder to do like five times windmills next to things, depending if people are
They're harder to do, though.
Like, I think that the one I use this game is a little bit different. And I was intentionally looking at the board for this, but the one that's 5 points per windmill that's touching a tool, all of the tool sections are right next to each other. So if you just build all in that area, you can max score that without a whole lot of effort. Now, granted, the rewards you're getting aren't necessarily huge because those are pretty close to the start for each of those windmills. But yeah,
50 points.
That's a ton. I mean, in a game that, I mean, granted, you won with 170, but I mean.
Yeah, I mean, that's how Jeremy won our last game.
Same card, I think, actually. Yeah. The tools, yep.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, the weirdness between some of them having fixed amount of scoring and some of them being just, you can just crank it up. Like, so I had the one that scores silver upgrades and, you know, you could put 11 on your board. Like, that's which is like...
It was 44.
So 44 from one thing where you max on a row at like 14.
But the worst part of that is you can score it twice.
Right.
Because
so,
if you wait to fill up that one space on your tulip board where you score one of your endgame scorecards twice, like I did that and I got 20 total points.
Yeah.
So you could theoretically get 88 points out of that. That's going to be my goal to do that sometime.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, so.
Hopefully someone ends the game before you can do that.
That's kind of goofy, but that's goofy.
Yeah.
It is goofy.
For me, I do not like the score goal card in the middle of the game space on the board. I think it's way too impactful and just.
Well, it's so early in that row, too. It's not even like you have to do a ton of flowers to get there.
I wouldn't mind it if, like, the cards got limited, like, had an upper limit,
like
right?
They all maxed down at 14 points or something like that. Yeah.
I think, you know, this has kind of already been said, but to give a specific example, like, there is you fill a whole row of red tulips and you get 10 points, but then there's also 2 points per red tulip. And so then it's just, I don't know, I mean, one is... just better than the other one in the fact that there's 14 points versus there's 10 points, but even more than 14 if you decide to go into some of the other rows and plant even more. Do you think that's viable to really just plant like all of one?
No.
And take those negatives and just go ham with the points?
I don't think so.
I mean, if you fill it well, if you did 2 rows of red and you like, would that, I don't remember if that would score the full row one twice.
I think it would, the horizontal row.
It would, but you'd lose a ton of points the other way. I think, and that's my other con, is...
That might be a good idea, though.
The end game row scoring isn't really that thrilling. Like, I feel like when I saw that, I'm like, oh, I bet that's hard to do, to like make your whole row the same color. No, like, it's not. Mm. And then it's nice at the end, if you really want to, you could put a different one and not get a negative point value for the column and still fill the row and get some kind of points.
But it's like, why is that not penalized at the end and it is at the beginning?
Yeah, I don't know. It's just kind of...
I think it's probably more like just to fill your board.
Yeah, like the scoring's kinda fine. Yeah. Like, but I just I thought that would be a bigger hurdle in this game to like for filling those rows out, I guess. But it seemed not...
It is
it's only like 4 points more to have all the same color there.
Yeah.
Like, I think maybe...
Well, except for in your columns, you lose points.
I understand. Yeah. But if you only work on three rows and never finish a column, you don't lose points, right?
Yes, you do.
Yeah, you lose points.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
But what if you decided to fill them all... Okay, next time I play this game, what if you fill them all but, like, make none of the same rows the same color... But like intersperse them.
Oh,
so
Azul.
Never...
He's saying Azul.
Yeah, so they're never the same color in a column.
You're just going to get less points on your horizontal rows?
Yeah.
Yeah, but have like a ton of purple in there and get a bunch of 3 points for your purple.
Here's the thing.
I think you're going to end up with
but maybe
the
still
same
the same
amount or less
if you,
number.
If you just
actual,
build,
that could be more interesting.
Build three full rows of the same color, and if you do black and get those windmills out. You build 21 black.
Times three.
You get one of those things that's like 10 points if you fill a black row. That's 30 points on that card. You get 2 points per the black flower card. I think you could do some crazy, like the 11
also,
points you would lose would be inconsequential.
It's like when you do that, when I try to do crazy stuff in Zulkin and fail and get
but
like
I think
4 points.
You can in this one.
No, I'm saying...
I don't know if you can get that many.
But I'm saying it's a fairly interesting thing. Like maybe you should try a wacky strategy and maybe if you hit, it's nuts. And if you miss, you score
if
like
that
no points.
If that is viable, then I like this game way more than I like it right now.
Well, nobody's tried it.
Yeah. I'm going to try it next time. Or maybe Jake will.
I think I'm going for it.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know why you couldn't get there. You would just have to get there.
I think, the game tells you. Yeah. It's like everyone's brain goes to, oh, this is what you have to do. Right. But maybe you can game around it.
It just feels normal. Like, I realized at the end of this game that a lot of the things I did really perfectly didn't actually earn me that many points. And then I ended up, you know, like 20 points behind the winner. But if I'd made like some of those weird concessions and started like just throwing down more black tulips to score like 3 more points every time I did it.
Just to clarify, since you lost by about 20 points, you got double smoked then, right? Because in the last podcast, losing by 10 means you got smoked. You got double smoked today.
Here's the thing is... according to my calculations, no.
you gotta understand that cam math.
Yeah.
Yeah. How many times has Rob played this game?
Is this the old cam corollary you get negative so many points for
like Jake had played Evenfall like more times than me.
I played it the same number of times as Rob and Tim.
Yeah, but what I'm saying is beating Jake by 10 points when he'd played more times than me, it was a smoke. But Rob has played Windmill Valley more times than me.
That was my fourth play of Windmill Valley.
Yeah, so he's played twice as much as me. So getting 20 points more, if you do the math,
So it's really only
played,
10 points.
Well, no, because like...
I was also being nice, though. You lost by 33 points.
Oh, well, yeah, he double smoked.
But it's wild. The first time I played, my worst score of this game is 83, and my best score is 170-some. So that's a pretty big range in a game like this.
And it's funny. I think I would imagine that your 83-point game, you went and did more actions on the wheel than you did in this game.
Probably.
Yeah.
I just did it better now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So. Well, and I am not shocked that you scored 83 points probably by not putting any contracts in.
Or I didn't get like a cool double scored contract or anything like that. All right, anybody else have any pros, cons before we get into final thoughts?
Let's do it.
All right, on the Board Boys podcast, we have a 3-boing rating scale, 3 being the best, 0 being the worst, 1 time only, and give your 4-boing game. Half boings are allowed. A 0-boing game of Windmill Valley is someone just drops a bunch of pesticides on your field and nothing.
The water's too high and it drowns all your tulips.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, like what happened, was it last year? So we have a...
not pesticide, I guess. Roundup.
A Dutch town here that has a tulip festival, but like it got really warm in like February, March, and the tulips started coming up, and then it got super cold and they all died. So
R.I.P. Pella.
Iowa.
And a 3-point game of Windmill Valleys. Your thing probably looks like the box. Or you know what? Campbell does some wacky black tulip strategy.
100% black tulips. You fill your board with black tulips.
And like,
and you think you're going to have only one spot open at the end, but you actually find a way to get it in there.
And he breaks that 200-point barrier because that the game comes a little chip that you can flip to the 200-point side. So
if you filled with all black tulips, it would be a stupid amount of points. Mm-hmm. Because like if you got those windmills out.
When you got the 2-point per black tulip card.
Because you get over 100 points in bonus scoring from your tulips. Alone, like you would, because it would be, yeah, maybe three times what 28.
You know what? Mm-hmm. If you can get both cards,
no,
if you can get both cards that score you for the rose and score you per,
that's what I'm saying,
per flower, and you're getting the flower points, I think it's totally worth it.
Yeah,
I'm most definitely.
I don't know.
We're playing this game wrong.
I mean, there's got to be enough black tulips in the box for everybody to get at least 7, right? So
yeah,
we're all playing the game incorrectly.
You just got to start threatening the other people who go after those black tulips.
Sometimes you gotta.
But are they considered to be peace limited?
I don't think they're peace limited. And I think, yeah, I think you know you got to think outside the box sometimes.
Now that is what I call the tulip bubble right there. You go. Yeah. Yeah. 28 black
Cam
tulips.
Just destroys the tulip market by planting all black tulips.
You right. Play the black tulips and then cut them all and take them to a My Chemical Romance concert.
Well, they'll be mad because it's not actually black; it's dark purple. Yeah. So
yeah, you can't get a true black tulip by reading the rules.
Dude, corporate emo would love black tulips so much. Fallout Boy, Dashboard Confessional.
All right, well, I'll go first. I'm gonna give this one a 2.5 boing. I gave it an 8 on BGG. I've kind of seesawed on it a little bit, and maybe it's just because I crushed it tonight and like figured out how to play the game better, but I think I do enjoy it. I think I like it for the length. I'm excited to maybe try. I haven't tried it with anything less than 4 players yet. I'm kind of excited to maybe just try it with 2, maybe teach Amy because I think she could play this one and would like it because flowers. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, just it's got enough player interaction with the water kind of thing, and then enough kind of, I guess, player randomization or asymmetry between like making your different things plus your boards are different. Yeah, I really like it. 2.5 points.
Am I next?
Sure.
Yeah, this game's good. I'm still thinking about how I could have done better at it, so that means I like it. Something about Danny Garcia's designs haven't spoken to me on a monumental level yet, but I want to give this one 2.5 boings, and maybe one day if I play it more I'll feel even better about it, but I don't think so. I don't think it's getting above 2.5 for me, but I think it deserves 2.5 boings, just like Rob said.
For me, I think I liked this play a little bit less than I did the first one. I think that there is a lot of cool things that you can do with the, you know, with your upgrades and how you lay them out, but I just don't know how much long-term replayability there is for me. However, I definitely think I will like it a lot more if it turns out to be viable that you can just completely, you know, ham-hand one type of tulip. So I think that would add a half boing for me at least, but I think it's a 2 boing for me.
I think what keeps this game out of maybe even touching 3 boings for me ever is that one spot that you always have to go to where you score an endgame scoring card again.
Yep.
Like, it's just, I don't think you could play the game without doing that.
Definitely not.
And on top of that, like, unless you're doing something crazy, you have to get an M game scoring card that is not limited by what's. Like,
but I think none of them are if you do things weird way. Yeah, I think grabbing points during this game is really, really powerful, and that's what boosts it up to 2.5 for me. Because I'm like, man, I'll just get a ton of endgame points, and these guys will watch my thing go around the track, and I'll catch up, and then I'll pass them. And then I was like looking at the end, and I was like scoring slightly better on all the endgame stuff than most of you guys. And I was like, it's not enough. I got close, but I didn't pass any of them, ever.
Yeah, like
ever.
Like the three of us at the end of the game were very, very close for endgame points. And then you guys kind of blew me away with the endgame cards, but then I ended up having more tulips on the board, mm-hmm. which was the determining factor.
With your windmills?
No, just his complete rows and columns.
Just complete rows, columns, plus, I mean, yeah, plus I had all but two tulips on the board, yeah. too. So. Yeah.
All right, but, right on. For me, two and a half for me. I agree with all this stuff. I think the endgame scoring cards and maybe some of the weirdness there, just I don't know that it will get up to a three. It could. I don't know. We'll have to see if someone does something crazy, then it is.
But. One less pro, like, in a year, I'm going to pull this game out and just know how to play it.
Yeah, it's not hard. Yeah. All right, cool. Well, that'll wrap us up for Windmill Valley on the Board Boys Podcast. We like to do something called the Bumper Dump. Cam, can you hit us with the music?
Baby, turn around. I want to see that sexy board game go Board Boys Bump.
Or Dump.
Black tulip petals on the... Black tulips and little boy smile.
Is this your
well,
was that?
I think we had black tulip petals on something would be a good dashboard confessional. Black tulips petals on the windows of my heart, because I can't read your rolling eyes. That wasn't a very good Chris Caraba.
All right.
Jake loves Dashboard Confessional, I bet.
I do like Dashboard Confessional. I saw them in concert not that long ago.
All right. Thunder Road Vendetta was our bumper dump. It was 8.1 for $15.98. It is now an 8.0.
Bump.
It's got to be a bump.
Yeah, it was bump. So it is now $4.82, but it's bumping into like pretty high on the... Let me pull it back up.
Like family?
Yeah, so like thematic is 73 and family is 80. So both of those things are kind of bumping up there for
I still don't understand what the differences are in those.
I don't know.
Is it because they're labeled as like a family game and then yeah. that's how they get put in there?
Probably.
Okay.
And then...
That makes sense. Like
know, whatever.
How they're categorized?
Yeah. Yeah. So, I don't know. You played it a bunch. I played it a bunch since we did the show.
Yeah, I don't. It's a 3-point game. It was my top game of the year. Well, close to my top game of that year. I don't know. I played it a bunch. I've taught it to a bunch of people. The more you play it, like now I just kind of know what everything does. So you can just quarterback a game as far as, oh, yeah, blah, blah, blah. Like makes the games go fast. Every game we played is like under an hour, which is like the right length for this game. And. Like Bo, I think it's in Bo's probably top five games. I think so.
Yeah, 4 points. It's a lot. Bo.
Yeah, it's Bo's one of Bo's 4-point games, yeah. And we've got that expansion where you just crash into each other a lot and blow each other up coming. So that's exciting.
Yeah. So you gave it a 2. Just heads up.
Oh, I know. I've upgraded to a 3 in the past.
Yeah. So more plays, higher rankings. I would say the same thing for me.
Yeah.
More plays, higher rankings. All right. If you want to give us some feedback, you can do so on our Board Game Geek Guild. You can find that on the website. Christopher Boat says this game is gnarly, awesome production value, and it's sweet, explosive action. Those mini expansions add some really cool stuff too, like the big rig smashing through everything on the map. Just the right amount of chaos and choices. 3 boings for him. BJ from Board Game Gumbo, he agrees with Chris. He wishes he owned this game and is a 3-boinger, and you can take that to the track. It's with the expansion, are they redoing the Kickstarter and stuff? We can kind of get it like...
Yeah, you can get it all. I mean, at Gen Con, they had a huge display of them for sale. So like, I think you can just get them off their web store right now.
Okay, cool. Our buddy Jeremy Dobler, hot take, 1 boing, maybe 1.5. He says he played the original version and its recent expansion before this version and its recent expansion when... was even announced, and then played the new Vendetta version. It's nearly identical game for gameplay. He just doesn't see the hype and doesn't is not impressed with the deluxification. It's one of those overproduced games for him.
So I think Jeremy, and he said this to me on the Discord, that like he thinks we pretty much gel on games.
Yeah.
But a couple of his things in the bump and dumps have made me think that he just doesn't like fun.
I mean.
Mic drop.
Well, all right.
Hey, Jeremy, maybe you should rethink that who you call the number one board boy after that slam.
Yeah.
So speaking of I mean, people who play tons of games with you, that would never say something like that about you on the podcast.
He knocked on challengers pretty good, too.
I mean, it sucks on BGA.
Yeah.
But he's played it with BJ in real life, so. Yeah.
I mean,
and how do you play a game with BJ in real life and not have fun?
Easily. Hey, Jeremy, my love for you doesn't. I don't care what games you like, buddy. I'll play anything with you on board game arena. I'll never even complain about it. And you call Rob the number one board boy. I don't think I didn't see that one time you said that.
Hey, BGG Con fall, I'll get to play with him for the first time in real life. So
nice. I mean, and he's gonna come up to Iowa and punch you in the face after that comment.
That's
so
fine.
We'll play some games then.
Bring it.
Yeah. All right. Jeremy Thoman. This game hits on the price versus gameplay versus deluxe problem with me. He gives it 2.5 boings, but probably should be 3, probably because the price is too high. He wanted to have played it with his family, but he doesn't want the retail version. Doesn't want to spend the money on the awesome version. And then Nate Simmons. He went all in on the most recent Kickstarter. I've only played the base game a couple times, but those two times have been super memorable, and the stories that get retold from reliving the moments from sliding past opponents only to hit a wall and shoot shrapnel at another player, causing them to blow up. Totally agree with that. Or the sandworm comes out and eats
somebody.
The
last two times we played, somebody won because someone in front of them exploded, and then they took a ramp to victory.
Yeah.
And when somebody ramps for the win... It's so fun.
It's fun, yeah. For a game that plays so quickly with little overhead and great memories, I thought it was worth to snatch all the expansions. Overall, he gives it 2 boings. So,
Rob, remind me, I played one time, I played as the truck.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I won, I think. But didn't you pass me and then ramp and then end up in a pit?
Yes.
Isn't that how I ended up winning the game?
Yeah.
Very possibly.
Yeah.
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 Yeah, that game's tight.
Yeah, and
just like the stories that happen,
I'm pretty sure
totally worth it.
An earthquake happened and knocked a bunch of people off and like destroyed, like eliminated two players, and then the dune sandworm came and ate the person in first place.
Any game with emergent storytelling that isn't like where you don't read a paragraph off of a card is so much better to me than where you read stuff off of a card. And so that's why I love Root so much, because the emergent storytelling in Root is always so good. The Thunder Road was the bomb.
Since it's one of his favorite games, let's get a quick blurb from Board Boy Bo about Thunder Road.
So I remember playing one time, and I was playing with my dad at Dungeons Gate, and I was about to win, I think. Then I ramped. Ended up exploding. Jeremy, I think it was Jeremy. He ramped, and then he made it, and then he won. Or did he get stuck? And then you ramped. And then some crazy ramp stuff happened.
It was a lot of crazy ramps. I know Jeremy won.
Thunder Road, more like Thunder Road.
So what's your boing rating right now? Is it your 4 boing game?
Yeah.
You only get one.
I have infinite 4 boings.
Oh, jeez.
Thunder Road? More like Thunder Road is what Bo says.
Vendetta.
All right. Well, thanks for listening to another episode of the Board Boys Podcast, Season 15, Episode 5, Windmill Valley, or if you're my wife, Windmill Valley.
Hey, things we were talking about the last cast. I threw a poll out there on the Discord. I was just thinking about this while we were talking about Discord and coming to the end of a podcast. I put a Ernest versus Mr. Bean poll out there, and Ernest swept it 5-3. We would call that we smoked the competition.
Is that a sweep? Isn't a sweep usually mean the other side wins 0?
Not in my scoring.
It's cam math. So go to theboardboys.com. You can check out all our links from there. You can join our Patreon, support us. We'd much appreciate it. Give us ratings on Spotify and iTunes. Say nice things about us. We love it. Or you know what? Just be honest. And the Discord link is on there as well, where you can join some BGA games. Come and say hi. We've had some new entries on there as of recently. And I'd like to thank our patrons now. Hammond Buckland, BJ from Board Game Gumbo, Timothy Crisco, Shifty Teeth, Jeff Gray, Andre Bosch, Braden Dowdy, Rob Cooper, Richard Lane, Matt Kelly, Jeremy Thoman, and Dom Lakin.
Hey, and one final thing. That Ernest versus Mr. Bean poll was a best of one, in which Ernest won 5-3. So he did sweep Mr. Bean 1-0. So there we go.
Got it.
Until next time, we hope you like board games.
Listen, very soon there will be a party for the world. I love Steve Walsh. It's that Steve Walsh time of year. I even played the whole song on the podcast last night. Yeah. for anybody who listened after the after this part right here. Boing, boing, boing.
Jasmine's in bloom.